Hello friends, this is Yusuf here. Welcome to part 6 of our crash course RPG Jelly. So in this video we are going to learn about arrays. Okay, so arrays is one of the important or most frequently used thing in the programming generally. So in RPG Jelly also we have the arrays concept. So let's quickly see the things which we are going to see in this video. So primarily we are going to see what is array and what are the different types of array. So compile time array and runtime array. Okay, so we'll see that, and then we'll see some of the important built-in functions which will be used for us to access the array. Okay, so in general arrays are nothing but a collection of one or more similar items. Okay, so that's the same in RPG array also. So let's quickly create an array and then see what happens. So as I said, there are compile time array and runtime array. Okay, so compile time array is something like you will give the values directly in the program, and during the compilation the program will take the values and then it will assign to the array. But the runtime array is something like that: when the program runs, then only we'll assign the values into the array, then we'll start using it. Okay, so let's quickly see how to define an array. So I'm creating a new program. Okay, so just skeleton. So we're going to create a new array. So I'm taking F4. So yeah, before I go to creating an array, I'm just wanted to give one tip. During our previous videos, right, I said we can have a bigger length of variable names. Okay, and a few people might be wondering how can we give a bigger variable length, because you can see this particular name is actually kind of 15, I think, some length. Okay, so we can give the bigger length. Say for example, I am going to create one bigger variable name, like this is big vary. As of now, it goes till that level, but I'm just declaring this S, and then maybe 10a. Okay, so now it seems like it's a variable name, but what if I want to have like a variable like this? Okay, it will show an error. Okay, because that length is not enough. You can see it here. Okay, so what I'm going to say for this, right, I can go and create another line. Basically we can split this declaration into two lines. Okay, and I'm just going to say this stuff totally. Okay, so I can cut it, and then in the down I can paste it. Okay, and then on the top I can have a very big variable b. Okay, whatever you want, and then you have to give three dots. So once you've done that, right, what will happen, this will be your variable name, and then the declaration will follow on the next line. Okay, so this is the one thing I want to tell. So maybe if you are in a situation where you want to have a bigger variable, meaningful variable name, you can use this. Okay, so let's quickly go to our array stuff. So I don't want a bigger thing, so I'll delete it. So I'm going to say arr for array, and then length is, I'm going to take a numeric array, so 3s0. So 3s0 represents a single numeric thing. Okay, this arr is a variable which is decimal variable, but I'm going to say dimension of 10. So by giving this dim of 10, the system will understand that okay, this arr variable can hold 10 numbers. Okay, so if I give here 3a, then it will think the arr variable will hold 10 different 3 character values. Okay, so as of now let's have this 3s. Okay, so how do we access the element? So in RPGLE the array starts with index 1, so you can assign something like arr of 1 equal to 1, arr of 2 equal to 2, something like that. But we don't want to keep on going to this manually assigning stuff, so we can use a for loop. Okay, while using a for loop, right, so the basic thing what people will do, like for I equal to 1 to 10, okay, and n for, and inside that we can have something like, okay, instead of this variable we can make it as I, so that become arr of 1 2 3, like that. And instead of values I'm just going to say I. So it will take 10 iteration and it will load first 10 numbers into the array. But I'm going to tell another thing. Okay, this is a normal thing, but you can use, instead of the hard-coded number, right? You can use a built-in function called ELEM, okay, or otherwise called as elements. So you can here give the array ARR. So what this will do, this will dynamically get the size of the array, okay, so that we don't need to hard code it anywhere else. So if we do this one, so probably what it will do, it will just create an array. So I'm going to display the array. So I'm going to say for I equal to 1 to the element of array n for, and inside I can just simply say dsply arr of I. So this will probably display everything. So if you just compile this and then test arr, okay sorry, I got it. Same stuff. So we need to initialize, sorry, create the variable I. So this I could be s 2s 0 0 0 0, okay. I'm going to compile it. So TSTARR. So if you call TSTARR, then you'll be able to see the first 10 values which we have stored in the array we have retrieved. Okay, so this is pretty much like creating array and assigning the values into array and then displaying it actually. But in most cases, we need to access the arrays in a different mechanism. Okay, one such mechanism is actually the lookup. So okay, before that, whatever we are seeing is now is actually a runtime array. I'll come back to the compile time array at the end of the video. So in general, a lookup function is one of the common function in arrays. We'll be using that a lot of time. So a lookup function is useful to check if a particular element is available in the array or not. Okay, if it is available, it will give you the position of that element. If it is not available, we will get 0. Okay, so in this case, we just noticed that this array is now having values of 1 to 10. So I'm just going to see what will happen if you want to retrieve something. So here I'm going to say lookup. So lookup will take the first argument, the actual number you want to search. So I want to search number 8, okay, then colon, then you want to pass the array. So here our array name is arr, okay. So if you give simply like this, then which means it will search for the 8 in the entire array, okay. So we'll take this one example, and then here it will return you the index number. So what I'm going to say here, idx equal to this one. So we are searching a number 8 inside the whole array, okay, and then we'll try to display idx. Okay, now what I'm going to say, I don't want this for loop, I'll delete it, okay, and then copy before, okay. So now I'm going to search 5, okay, but here the array, the second parameter is same. We can also give a third parameter, which is the starting number to search from, okay. Say for example, if I give 6, okay, what will happen, it will start searching from 6, okay. So in this case, the 5 is already available in the position 5. So let's see what happens if we start searching from 6, okay. This is one example, and also we have another argument, okay, in the lookup function, the third one, which is actually the number of element you want to search, okay. Say for example, you have a 100 length array, you want to start at maybe 50, but you want to search only the 10, okay, like that. So here what I'm going to say I want to search 3, okay, and you can start from 1, okay, and then I'm saying you end in 3, okay, just to make it work, we will say 4. Okay, I'm expecting the negative result here, because I want to show you that this 1 and 3 is playing a role in the selection criteria, so that we are not getting the result. So now we have 3 kind of lookups. So I'm going to compile it. For the benefit, I can compile it in debug mode so that we understand very clearly. Okay, so same stuff. We always forget to initialize this. We also have I, so let us take it. So compiled, so strdbg tstarr, call tstarr. So here you can see it will just keep on assigning the values. I'm just going to give a breakpoint and then press F12. So now we are in the IDX line. So I'm searching here. So you can see this IDX is now having value 8. So this 8 is not the value 8, this 8 is actually the index number 8, okay. And then here I'm executing it again, and then now we are searching 5 from the starting number 6. So this IDX now it will be having the value 0 because it is not finding any match from 5 to the remaining thing, sorry, from the index 6 it is not able to find the element 5. So next again we are searching the third one. Now again see we are searching 4, okay, from 1 to 3. So obviously we will not be getting anything, so you can see this will be again 0. So that is the usefulness of lookup function. But we have few more lookups. Let me go and show that to you. If you come down, okay, there is a lookup XX, okay. So XX can be replaced with few things, something like this, okay. You can see it here, right? So we have a LT, GE, GT, LE. So nothing but less than, greater than or equal to, so greater than and then less than or equal to, okay. So to use these functions, right, we need one requirement. Okay, the requirement is nothing but the array should have been either ascending order or descending order. Okay, so how do we tell array is ascending order or descending order? So we can tell that using a keyword called ascend or descend, which is a kind of optional keyword. If you go here, when you declare this function array, right, so you can give here after the DIM, you can give ascend, okay, like this. You can give ascend or descend. But please note that just by giving ascend and descend, it won't automatically arrange the values, okay. Even if you give ascend but you are like loading the value in a descending order, it doesn't store it in ascending order. So it just stores however we are ascending it, okay. But just the fact that if you want to use any of these lookup XX function, we should have been given this particular keyword in the declaration itself, okay. That is the part I want to highlight. So as you see here, less than nothing but, okay, if you give a number or a string, okay, if you're trying for less than, it will search for a value which is lesser than that value, and then greater than or equal to, greater than, less than or equal to, all the same stuff. You can read the documentation. Maybe I can give the link in the description. Okay, one important point. This lookup function will return the first match. Okay, say for example, if you have more than one value in the same array, then it will, whatever the it matches first, then it will give you the index of that particular number. Okay, so that is a important point. Okay, so that's about the lookup, and we have seen this element function also. So this is used for finding the size of the array. Okay, and then let's go to the sort. So one of the function, important function of the array is actually a sorting one. So if you want to sort, we have an inbuilt function called sort A. Okay, so temporarily I'm going to remove this. I'll tell why. Okay, so now what we have just seen is actually we loaded the value from 1 to 10 into the array ARR. Okay, and then so now let's see, I want to display the array. So what we'll do, we'll copy this thing, and then we'll say from 1 to element of array, instead of array I can say DSPLY of ARR of, we just saw this as a first example. But now what I'm going to say here, okay, SORTA, okay, sort A, okay, and then I can give the array name. So here something like ARR. Okay, so when you use sort A of ARR, it will default sort in ascending order. But fortunately or unfortunately, our array is already in ascending order. So what I'm going to go here, I'll take a bracket. What happened? Okay, comes late. Okay, I can give D. Okay, so okay, what is the issue? Oh, okay, first of all, one update. Currently the pub 400 is down, okay, so I'm not able to access it, and this is another server which I have access called Texas 400. But fortunately or unfortunately, this is a v6r1, okay, but our pub 400 is v7r3. So there are some functions which is not supported in v6r1. So that might be this one, like sort A of AID, because I tried that in pub 400, it worked. I don't know why it is showing syntax error here, but anyway, So we have a sort A of A or D actually option. I don't know what is happening here. So if I give sort A of D, so it says extender is not allowed with the operation. So extender is nothing but whatever we give in the bracket is called extender. So the extender is not supported in V6 R1 version. So I'm just going to say sort ARR. So let's see what happens. I'm going to say copy this and paste it. Just to differentiate something between, I can say display sorted. So let's see what happens. Probably I think we will not see any changes here because we are loading in ascending order, we are displaying it, we are again sorting in ascending order. So we can see after sorted it's just displays the same. So what I'm going to do now, just to make it work here, instead of loading I, I'm going to load 10 minus I. Okay, you know what will happen, right? So every time it will load, I can even load 11 minus I so that it load from 10 down to 1. So file, compile, call test ARR. Now you can see first it's coming in reverse order because we are loading in reverse order, but after sorting it's coming in ascending order because the sort function by default it's ascending order. Now the question is, okay, I have my ascending order data, then how can I sort? Okay, I think or I guess this could be the approach, which is nothing but while defining your this thing, we can give descend. Okay, I think the spelling is correct. Okay, so while defining, I'm telling this array is basically a descending order array. Okay, but I'm loading in ascending order, so I'm just give I, so it will become 1 2 3 4. Okay, and then I just say sort A. So the sort A is by default will take the order based on what we specified in the header. Okay, so I think that is the V6R1 version, but the newer version we can even specify the sort A whether ascending or descending order in the extender. Maybe I'll show an example after pub 400 came up, but as of now let's look into this example. So we have declared the array as descending order, but while loading we are loading in ascending order and we are just issuing a sort A command, and let's see what happens. So probably this should work. Okay, so 14 is call test ARR. So now we see it's loading in ascending order, but since we give sort A, it's coming in descending order. Okay, so the sort A function just takes how to sort from the declaration itself, and then it just does the sort accordingly. Okay, but this particular thing which I have here, okay, so this is the syntax for the V7, I think 7.1 and above will be supporting this. Okay, so to use this, right, we don't need to give anything on the header level like ascending or descending anything. Directly we can specify something like this, okay, which is sort a of a, we can specify like this, or I, okay, or sort a of d. So both will work in ascending and descending. Okay, so that's about sorting. Now another two important things called subarray and exfoot. So subarray will be used when you want to extract a particular array's one particular content. Okay, so subarray is something similar to the substring or what we have in character built-in function. Okay, so let me quickly do that. So we have this array already here, so I can delete this stuff I don't want as of now. I'm in browse mode, so let me go to edit mode. So let me go and delete this stuff. Okay, so now we have this array already in ARR, so I'm just going to say ARR of 1. Okay, it is my new array, and ARR of SUB ARR. So subarray, we need to give the first argument, which is nothing but ARR, okay, colon, and I'm going to say I want from 4 and 8. Okay, so this will copy from 4 to 8 into the array 1. The only requirement is the array 1 should be able to hold the data. So it can even have higher number of data, but it should not have the lesser number of data. Okay, what I mean is actually we need to create another array, in this case array 1, right? We can either give the same 10, but it will just load the first 4, or you can even give here a dimension of 4, which will exactly load whatever it is. So as of now, I'm just going to give 10, okay, and then let's see what happens. So file, okay. After it assigned, we need to see the result. But still, okay, we can see in debug mode. 14 debug IO source. So okay, we got an error. Let's see what is the error. Or even this is not supported in V6 R1. Oh my god, I don't know. let's see what is the error. Okay, the third parameter is too big. The parameter ignore. Okay, so third parameter is too big. So let's go. What we give? We give 4. Oh, sorry. So the third parameter is actually the number of elements. Okay, it's not the ending index. So from 4, we do not have the 8 element. Okay, because totally we have 10. So I have to give here. Come on, 4. Okay, from 4 we need 4. Okay, this should work. File. No. I want to compile it. Okay, strdbg tstrr call tstrr. Okay, so let's see. As of now, I'm just going to give f6 f12. Okay, so now if you give here and then press f11, you should be able to see the value. I don't know why it is like this. So let's give like this. Okay, anyway, so we have this 1 to 10. Okay, so similarly, now I'm going to press F10 so that this copies the data here. So now I can give EVARR of 1, should be able to see the data. So we can see from 4 to 7 it's available. Okay, so the starting index 4 it takes into account. So we'll get from 4, 5, 6, 7. So 8 is not included. Okay, be that in mind. Okay, so that is for the subarray. Okay, then one last thing what we're going to see is actually the X4. So X4 is kind of I just noticed X4. It is useful for computing the sum of the array if the array is actually a numeric. Okay, so I think that really can show you the result. So now you know that the same array we can take. Okay, so we have this array loaded into 1 to 10 values, and then if you sum all the values, we'll get the answer 55. Okay, so what I'm going to say here, DSPLY, we're going to display the value and X foot of ARR. So that's it. So when you do this, what will happen? It will compute the sum of that array. Anything happening? Oh, it is taking too long. Come on, man. Okay, so call tstrr f10. Okay, so now you see the value 55 because we loaded the array from 1 to 10. So if you sum the values from 1 to 10, it's 55. So that is the usefulness of xfoot. It might be useful if you want to do so. You don't want to do a loop and then come add the values one by one. Okay, and then one last thing is actually we can even add to arrays using xfoot. Okay, so I'm going to give an example. So what I'm going to say, cc before. Okay, and we already have array of 1, so I'm just going to say here array of 1. Okay, and then instead of here I'll say array of 1. Okay, so now array 1 is having 1 to 10, array 1 is also having 1 to 10. So here I'm going to say array plus array 1. Hopefully this should work in V6 R1 because it will work in V7 or V7. Okay, so compile. Yes. So call tstrr. Now you see 110, correct? So because we are adding two arrays. So the export is actually even takes two parameters of two different arrays. But I think the constraint is both should have the same length. Okay. And it will try to compute the sum of. Okay. So that's it for this video. So I hope you got some understanding about arrays. And okay, compile time array. Okay. So it's only 25 minutes. Anyway, I'll cover it. Because compile time array, nowadays we are not using it in the modern programming languages or in modern programming ways. But still we have older programs which still has some compile time array. So it's good to understand what it is. Okay, so fine. So we are going to create a compile time array. So let us go and then create CTRR. Okay, compile time array. And we can declare the same way exactly what we declared above. Okay, so 3s 0 dim of 10. Okay, now we have created a compile time array. But to make the program to understand it's a compile time array, we need to give something like CT data. Okay, so CT data, which means compile time data. Okay, and then we have another parameter called PERREC. Okay, per record. So I'm giving 5 as of now. I'll explain what is this 5 mean. So to give a more clarity, what I'm going to take, I'm going to take this 3S to 3A. Okay, I'll tell why. So now we have declared. Keyword name is not valid. Okay, one second. What is wrong here? So we'll say dim of 10, it will work, but to make it C data. I think it's a P per REC of 5. Oh my god, okay, let's wait. Give me a moment. Okay, I think all are correct. Only thing what I see as a difference is actually okay. RCD, shit. Okay, sorry for the delay. So the problem is actually the per RCD, okay, it's not REC. Okay, anyway, so here we declared something like CTARR, okay, and then that is having a 3 character field of 10 occurrence, okay, but we say it's a CT data, which means a compile time data and a per record 5. So once we set this right, the compiler will expect the data inside the same program. So how we need to define actually, if you come down, what I did wrong. Okay, so if you come down at the end of the program, okay, you give a, okay, initially it will be something like the F11, okay, you will see the header here actually, okay, but there is some data on the left hand side also. If you press shift F7, you will see those data, okay. If you come to base down, the last line of the record, okay, the last line of the record, you need to start from here, a star CT data, okay. So at the end of the program, we need to start star CC data, and then we can directly give the data. So I'm going to give something like ABC 1 2 3. So we have defined the compile time array with a single column field of length 3A, okay, so 3 character. So each this ABC is a one value, and 1 2 3 is one value, and maybe I can give even space 0 space, and then again XYZ. Okay, so now you can see we have given one ABC 1 2 3 0 XYZ, and we can give another variable like EEE. So now we have given 5 records. Okay, so this is the per record is they are like explaining. Okay, so we're gonna have 5 records per row. Okay, and then now we need another row because total of it is having 10 elements. Okay, so we have declared 5 here, so I can give a repeat. And then I give something, okay, ABCDEFGHIJKLMN. Oh, okay, so this is the data for the compile time array. Okay, now once you have it right, so how do we access it? So maybe I can show some demo. So I'm gonna say here CTARR of so here see, say for example I want the XYZ, okay, then 1 2 3 4, so the 4 is actually the index of it. So just to display it, I can say DSPLY. Okay, and then also I can say something like maybe I want MNO. Okay, so MNO is actually the 10th record, so I can simply hear 10. Okay, and here important thing is you need to make the arrangement correctly, so the spaces, everything. So okay, so if you want this record, it's called 1, 2, 3rd record, so I can give here 3. Now let's compile it. Hopefully we shouldn't get any errors. 14, we got error. Very good. So what it says? I have not used compile time array for the recent days. Okay, so sorry for those mistakes. So now what is the mistakes? Nothing but okay, simply by giving CD data, it will understand it's the data, but it don't know for which array it is actually. So we need to give after the space, we need to give the our array name. Okay, then it will understand, okay, this data is for the CT array data. File, compile. Now it should compile. Yes. So call test here. So now you can see those values appeared here, X, Y, Z, M, and all those stuff. Okay, so it's already 30 minutes. So hope now you got a brief idea of how to use arrays. Okay, and what happened? Okay, anyway, so that is the end of this video. So arrays are very useful. Hopefully these built-in functions will be useful for you to manipulate the arrays. Okay, so the next video will be the data structures, because here you may having a question like, so it's all single dimension array, so how do you define a multi-dimensional array? Okay, so we need data structure for that, so I'll be covering that in the next video. So we'll see what is a multi-dimensional array and what is the data structure all about. The data structure is actually kind of a big topic, so I have already split that into two sections, so we'll see that in the next video. So that's it for this video. I hope this helps, and thanks for watching. Yusuf signing off.